Hello everybody and welcome to another video. Today we're going to dive deep into abnormal psychology or psychopathology. It really depends on your university or college. But we're going to be talking about the 10 most tested disorders that will appear on your final exam in that course. So as I go through the 10 disorders, I'm going to be giving a brief description and DSM-5 criteria of that specific disorder, as well as looking at the recommended treatment for the disorder. And then what I'm going to try and do is find movie clips or TV clips of characters that exhibit these characteristics and put them into the video so that hopefully you can see not a real life example necessarily, but a good depiction of the disorder to kind of help wrap your head around it. Please remember to like, comment, share, and subscribe to my channel. It really helps me along the way. It allows you to see more content like this in the future. All right, so I think we can get started. Number one, we have major depressive disorder. And so what this is characterized as through the DSM-5 criteria is five or more of the following: depressed mood most of the day for most of the days, loss of interest or pleasure, weight loss or gain, insomnia or hypersomnia, so that's sleeping too little or sleeping too much, fatigue or feelings of worthlessness, hopelessness, or decreased concentration, or even thoughts of suicide. As you can see with major depressive disorder, it can kind of be on two ends of a spectrum here. You can either be, like I said, gain a lot of weight, lose a lot of weight, sleep a lot, not sleep a lot. So there is a lot of variability allowed within these criteria. Now, I did mention that five of these must be present, and they also must be present for at least 2 weeks. How you go about treating depression is actually relatively straightforward. The most common drug treatment is through SSRIs, Prozac for an example. What they really do is they block the reuptake of serotonin in our brain. So serotonin is released and it actually just sticks around for a little longer. And as I mentioned in a lot of my other videos, serotonin is the happy hormone. So obviously this leads to increased mood and can decrease a lot of the depressive symptoms. If you don't want to go the drug treatment route at all, CBT or cognitive behavioral therapy has been seen to be very, very, very effective when treating major depressive disorder. And here now we'll look at an example of major depressive disorder. It's a possibility.
When you left, there's a possibility. When he left, you took everything with you. But the absence of him is everywhere I look. It's like a huge hole has been punched through my chest.
Number two, we're going to be looking at generalized anxiety disorder. And so the definition from the DSM criteria is excessive worrying about a variety of things with little to no control over those worries. And this needs to exist for 6 months or more, so half a year. Again, treatment is pretty standard. It's pretty easy to treat. And so if you're going to go the drug option, we look at benzodiazepines as well as antidepressants. Now, one thing you really need to know about benzos is it only works for a certain amount of time. It is super, super effective 100% of the time. However, it can only be used for 8 weeks until it isn't as effective. So what you see is a lot of people start with benzos and start going to therapy. And so it's really like a push in the right direction. It's what you might use right when you're starting treatment to just kind of give you a leg up when you don't know how therapy is going to go. You haven't learned the practices that they're going to teach you. It can really help during those first 8 weeks. But the hope is that you will then get off them after 8 weeks and you'll continue with therapy until you've gotten to a point where you actually don't need either. And so CBT or cognitive behavioral therapy, again, is seen to be very, very, very effective when treating anxiety disorders. And the movie I'm going to be highlighting today is Inside Out. If you haven't watched it and you're interested in mental health at all, I really, really, really recommend this movie. It's a fantastic depiction, kind of put in easy terms. It's really great for children as well, but it does not need to be a children's movie. be. It can really just help you increase your emotional intelligence a little bit.
Wait, what?
Almost finished with the potential disasters. Worst scenario is either quicksand, spontaneous combustion, or getting called on by the teacher. So as long as none of those happen.
Okay, everybody. We have a new student in class today.
Are you kidding me? Out of the gates, this is not happening!
And number three, we're looking at bipolar disorder, and we're going to be describing the differences between bipolar 1 and bipolar 2 disorder. Specifically, bipolar 1 is depression, so major depressive disorder, along with at least one manic episode. And so a manic episode is defined as three or more of the following: inflated sense of self, little need for sleep, talking loudly and rapidly, easily distracted, increased activity, engaging in risky behaviors, and racing thoughts. So you need three or more of those, and they need to exist for at least 1 week. Now, bipolar 2 disorder is a little bit different. Again, you have the major depressive disorder, but instead of a full-on manic episode, you have one or more of hypomanic episodes. And so this is just slightly less intense, I guess, as a manic episode would be. These symptoms only have to last 4 or more days in this case, and they don't need to be as severe as seen in manic episodes. So treatment for bipolar disorder is done through certain drug treatments, either through lithium or valproate. And now lithium is very, very toxic and can actually be very damaging if not taken properly and taken under the advisement of healthcare professionals who really know what they're doing. So a lot of the times you see people with bipolar 1 disorder specifically who are going to be taking lithium go to a treatment facility for a certain duration of time. And this is just because now in that treatment facility, they can monitor the patients very closely because lithium does sometimes result in suicide ideation very early on in the treatment plan. And so obviously we want to be taking very good care of these individuals and really watching and making sure that they don't go through a suicide or that they have the resources they need to kind of alleviate those thoughts. And again, CBT or cognitive behavioral therapy has been seen to be very effective in these cases. And the movie we're going to be talking about today is Silver Linings Playbook. So insert the clue.
Mom, I can't find my wedding video. Mom, wake up.
What is it?
Where's my wedding video?
It's after 3 o'clock. What are you doing?
I looked in here, but this is all your shit up here for your sewing and everything. Did you put it up here?
What about in your father's study?
Don't go in my study.
Dad, not now!
Would you put it in here? Makes no sense for you to put it in here.
Patty, what are you doing?
He's got all his Eagles videos. We went to one video of my wedding. Is it here? I
mean, Patty?
It's probably in the attic.
What? Are you going in my study?
Feels to me like you want to hide my wedding video.
No,
you think I can't handle it?
Please stop yelling.
I'm not yelling, Mom. I'm just frustrated because I should have my wedding videos.
Pat!
Pat! I already looked all over there. Get up! Here! I'm not calming down. I don't give a f- who here. I'm not calming down. Anybody can wake up. I'm not ashamed of it. I'm not ashamed of it. Let the whole neighborhood wake up. I don't care.
Stop it! Stop it!
No, and number four. We're going to be talking about obsessive-compulsive disorder. The definition is the possession of recurrent obsessions, which are essentially just intrusive thoughts, followed by compulsions, which are actions to alleviate those intrusive thoughts. And so CBT and exposure therapy has been seen to be incredibly effective in obsessive-compulsive patients. And so what you might end up doing in CBT is something called exposure and response prevention. And so what this is, just for an example, let's say a patient came in and they have obsessive-compulsive disorder, and specifically they are afraid of germs and like to wash their hands repeatedly, and so much so that maybe their hands begin to crack or bleed. And so it's really something we need to address. And so what they might end up doing in therapy is through graded exposure, which is just small tasks leading up to the very, very scary thing, is tasks leading up to using a public restroom and perhaps not washing your hands, just walking out. And so yeah, it might be gross. And most of you probably might be thinking, well, I don't do that. Like, I wash my hands and that's just the proper thing to do. But the point is you want to get the person to be able to do the scariest thing that there is. And if they can do that, then they can go about their daily tasks without washing their hands 20 times a day. And so yes, CBT in this way, specifically with exposure and response prevention, is seen to be incredibly responsive and efficient in treating obsessive-compulsive disorder. And so if we're going to look at a movie here, I would recommend watching Matchstick Men. And so again, let's insert the clip.
Roy? Hey, okay, I did that.
Come on, Roy, come on, really, man.
One, two, three.
Come on.
Take your shoes off.
What? Why?
Take your shoes off or you don't come in.
You need to take your clothes, did you? I'm taking them off.
Number five, we have PTSD or post-traumatic stress disorder. And the definition here is that the person must have exposure to an actual or even threatened traumatic incident. And then this needs to be followed by 1 month of intrusive thoughts, perhaps avoidance of reminders of this event, negative changes in mood, and alterations to physiological arousal. So maybe feeling alert all the time. And so CBT with gradual exposure has been seen to be very effective in these cases. And specifically, again, like the OCD example, now we're going to be slowly taking steps towards the scary thing again. However, this time we don't need the response prevention part. And the movie I want to be talking about today is Perks of Being a Wallflower, which is one of my favorite movies. You can see that the main character often has flashbacks towards his past. And that is very representative of PTSD for a lot of people.
It'll be our little secret, okay? Look, Charlie, she's fast asleep. Don't wake your sister.
We have schizophrenia, as defined by the DSM, is a mixture of positive or additional and negative or lacking symptoms, including delusions, hallucinations, evolution, which is the inability to initiate or persist with activities, also seen in depression sometimes, anhedonia, which is the absence of pleasure, again, seen in depressive disorders sometimes. Also, you can see affective flattening, which is kind of emotionless facial expressions, as well as disorganized behaviors. Though a lot of people say that schizophrenia can't be treated, this is not true. With therapy and medications, people can live very, very normal lives. The first line of treatment is often antipsychotic medications, which can be very effective, but often lead to patient withdrawal. A lot of people stop taking medications and therefore symptoms come back. But it is a very difficult medication to take because of the various side effects that do arise. Again, CBT has been found to be very effective, and specifically when challenging maladaptive thoughts, sometimes challenging those delusions, those types of things. Another movie that is absolutely fantastic, and I would just recommend that you watch it because a lot of people haven't heard of this movie, is the movie A Beautiful Mind.
Well, this guy tries to wander into the library, but he doesn't have ID.
Why can't people read their memos, huh?
Then he goes totally nuts.
God's real. We're not real.
Shit.
Is this what you are, soldier? Some useless ghoul? The local madman?
I'm no soldier.
You're gonna end up in a cell! Oh! Worthless, discarded.
There's no mission.
And while you rock and drool, the world will burn to ashes.
You are not real. You are not real.
You're still talking to me, soldier.
There's
no mission. I'm not a soldier.
John.
Number 7, we're going to be talking about anorexia nervosa. And yes, we do talk about many eating disorders within abnormal psych, but I would say anorexia as well as bulimia, which we'll be talking about next, are very tested on finals. And so the definition here is that dietary restriction really leads to a very low body weight. And that's characterized as a BMI under 17.5. And it's also characterized by an intense fear of gaining weight. And it interferes with daily activities. It often leads to a disturbed perception of their body. They often see themselves as a lot bigger than they actually are. And really, it's just governed by body image. And so individuals can either completely abstain from eating, or they can binge and then purge. That's totally anorexia nervosa and not bulimia if it leads to a low body weight. The treatment is sometimes very difficult. Eating disorders, and specifically anorexia nervosa, is one of the most lethal disorders there are, unfortunately. So depending on how severe the anorexia is, patients may be admitted to treatment facilities to participate in group therapy, to participate in individual therapy, and to really have their health monitored, because not eating for a long period of time or purging too much can lead to heart problems, metabolism problems, and all types of things that are very dangerous. And so yes, they may be admitted to hospitals or treatment facilities, and the main goal for the doctors treating them is to really get these patients to put on weight, because that is the main source of the lethality of this condition. And so once the weight has been put on, then they will participate in various types of therapy. And again, cognitive behavioral therapy is seen to be very effective. And so the movie here is To the Bone. I think it's on Netflix, and it is a very good depiction of anorexia and the challenges that individuals will face.
Got it under control.
Isn't it funny?
It's a cake. Got it under control. And got it under control.
Next, as I had mentioned, we're going to be talking about bulimia nervosa. And this is defined as, again, it's an eating disorder. However, it is binging followed by inappropriate compensation. And so that inappropriate compensation can be purging or throwing up the food, but it can also be excessive exercise. And I think that's something a lot of people don't know. It's really any type of compensation that is deemed inappropriate, so just a little bit too much. However, the difference between anorexia nervosa and bulimia is that you are still of a normal weight, so you're not a BMI of under 17.5. Treatment, again, CBT. In therapy, the patient is going to really focus on increasing their self-evaluation and changing their relationship with food. They look at identifying the dietary rules that they've set into place and challenging them. The clip for this is actually from a TV show. It's the only one on my list here, but if you've ever seen Gossip Girl, Blair Waldorf, one of the main characters in Gossip Girl, did have bulimia in her past, and she kind of spends an episode re-experiencing those difficult times. So again, insert clip. Number 9, we have major neurocognitive disorder, or what was known at some point as dementia, which some people may still be teaching it as, I'm not sure. The definition here is that there is significant cognitive decline in one or more areas. And this needs to really interfere with everyday activities. That's the key point here. Now, this can be due to Alzheimer's disease or vascular disease, or like a stroke, for example. Or it can be due to Parkinson's disease. Where it comes from doesn't really matter. It's all characterized as major neurocognitive disorder. Unfortunately, there is no treatment specifically for Alzheimer's disease. However, there are preventative measures that you should be taking to kind of help your chances of not developing Alzheimer's. Make sure that you have deep sleep every night, you eat heart-healthy foods, and that will really be seen to decrease the amyloid plaques that do sort of have a connection with major neurocognitive disorder. It is not proven, but it's thought to be the cause of the disease. Here we have a wonderful movie that I'm sure a lot of you have seen, and it is The Notebook.
Remember that story you were reading to me?
Yes.
Do you think that I could be here tonight? Would that be all right?
You know what we could do? Maybe we could get a car. We could go for a ride. We could get out of here and just go someplace. You want to?
I don't think so. Not tonight, darling.
Come on, why not? Wait. Why did you call me, darling? I don't know you.
What's going on here?
Am I supposed to know you?
Allie.
No. No! No!
Allie, sweetheart. Hey, Allie, I love you. Stay with me. Don't.
No!
You...
Number 10, we are almost done, and this is social anxiety disorder. And the definition here is extreme fear or anxiety of being in social situations where one might be criticized or judged, and thus the person may try to avoid those situations at all, or if they have to be there, if they have to endure it, they're going to be very, very scared, upset, distressed during the situation. It is treated again with SSRIs, which has been seen to be very, very effective. But more effective than this is group therapy, and specifically a CBT-oriented approach, so that people with social anxiety disorder can be exposed to group interaction, social interaction, and learn social skills with other people who are also struggling. And so it's not as scary of a situation as just going out into the world. And so the movie here is actually Amelie. It is a great movie, and it really depicts a character that does have social anxiety disorder and shows her journey throughout. Thank you so much for watching my video on the top 10 tested abnormal psych disorders. I hope that you learned something. I hope the movie clips kind of gave a more in-depth and rich understanding of this as well. If you do have any questions, make sure to comment them below. I will be answering them pretty regularly. Other than that, good luck on your final. I hope that your course was interesting and you got everything you wanted out of it. It was definitely one of my favorite courses I took in my undergrad. So again, congratulations.